mantles with us to provide music and a program for us. And I look forward, we have them here. It's a special occasion. Meeting, the bishop mentioned how nice they look and they're in their baptismal garb. So I think they had a little bit of class or sacrament. I appreciate them for them being here. Their director is Sister Jean McGuire, and I'll let her now announce the program.
The experience that I am having while being in this group. has helped me appreciate music in such a broader sense. I've decided to talk on music because it's had such an influence in my life. One of my favorite stories is about a little boy named Peter. Peter looked around the strange hospital room. This was probably the first night that he had ever been away from his family, and he was frightened, even though the nurses had promised him that they would stay close by. The doctors also tried to comfort him and explain to him just what was going to happen in his operation that was scheduled for the next morning. The hospital was very large and was full of unfamiliar sounds. The hospital was so crowded, and the only place available for Peter was in a little room in the next morning. The thought of all the sick men in a big room just outside his door was frightening. He did not want to cry, and for a moment he did not know just what he would do. Then Peter pulled the bed sheet right up around his chin and began to pray with all of his might that somehow he could stop going so afraid and alone. When Peter finished his prayer, there came into his mind a song he often sang with his friends in Sunday school that began, "Jesus loves me, this I know." The words to the song had always made Peter feel good, but this night they had such a comforting meaning for him that he thought he would burst if he did not let them out. He began to sing very softly at first, and then with growing enthusiasm. A nurse who was passing old Peter's room heard the small but clear voice singing the familiar song. The words sung in a sweet, childlike soprano voice could be heard all throughout the men's room. The men stopped their talking, turned off their televisions, and listened quietly. Tears ran down some of their faces, and as they heard the confirmations of a little boy singing, "Jesus loves me." I had a similar experience, just like little Peter did. Being in a hospital can be really scary and lonely at times. I remember when I was really little, being up in primary children's hospitals, and I was having some tests. I always carried a little stuffed bear with me that played a familiar tunes too. I remember the nurses singing along with me and doing hand actions with me. I remember feeling comforted by this simple little tune. Music affects all of us in all parts of our lives, whether we are happy or sad or in need of comfort. In DNC 136:28, we read, "If thou art merry, praise the Lord, with singing with praise, with dancing and with the prayer of praise and thanksgiving." In Carthage jail, prior to the martyrdom, Joseph Smith asked John Taylor to sing to him a poor wayfarer carrying down the tree. The last thing Christ did with the 12 apostles before going to the Garden of Gethsemane was to sing a hymn. In Matthew 26:26-30, we read, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many of the remissions of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.' And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives." I'm really thankful for the program that Ms. McGuire has allowed us to have at Beaumont High School. It has touched my life in so many different ways. And I'd like to bear my testimony. I know this church is true, and I know that Joseph Smith is a true prophet of the church. And I'd like to thank my family and all that they do for me, and my little sister. She's such a great example to me. She works so hard in everything that she does, and I just want to be like her someday. And I want to thank my teachers, my young leaders, for all that they've done for me. They've been such a great inspiration to me. And I'd like to thank my friends for all that they've done for me also. They're the best that I can ever find. Many things since the name Jesus Christ.
If you walk into any grocery store, you'll notice there's a couple aisles devoted all
already. And if you ask, where's the Thanksgiving stuff, they'll say, we've got turkey on aisle 7. But that's about it. I sometimes think that before we get all excited and caught up in the excitement of what we're going to get, we need to hold off on hauling out the holly, bringing up the Christmas tree, and putting on the mistletoe. Well, maybe the mistletoe can stay, but and sit back and remember to be thankful. And one of the things that I am most thankful for in my life, and of all the gifts that I have received from all the Christmases, none of them could actually even compare to the gift of a family that I've been born into. And a close second to that is good friends. And yet, I don't show these people how I feel for them. If somebody were to give you a brand new expensive car, and you were to just kill the sucker, I mean, just drive it 55 in second gear down the freeway, never clean it, never wash it, never, you know, do anything to help fix it, you won't have a car very long. And the person that gave you that vehicle will never want to get you anything again, most likely, especially something as valuable as a car. And yet I'm very guilty of treating people that I have valued the most in my life, of treating them very poorly and very often. Michael McLean wrote a song that says, essentially, are you giving the least to those who matter most? Or are you sharing your best with those that really aren't that close? Well, it's time to turn around and find out where your greatest joys are found. And many of us know that our greatest joys are found with our families and our friends. And yet it's not always perfect, and we don't always get along. And that's a big problem, because if we're going to be spending eternity with our families, well, eternity with people that you don't like or don't get along with is a long time. And I think the key to actually making that happy is to making your family be more like a friend that you really want to earn the respect and the love of. A friend that you really enjoy being with and a friend that you spend time with. And making your friends more like your family. And when that can happen, then forever we'll seem more like an eternal bliss. And it should be really easy for us to treat our friends like our family, because everybody's our family. We all have a relative in common, and that's our eldest brother. Let me tell you about my eldest brother. All my life, I've looked up to him. He's done everything. He's loved everybody unconditionally, no matter how hard and how mean they were to him. And he's loved especially me, because my brother Jesus Christ paid a debt that he didn't owe, because I owe a debt that I cannot pay. And the only way that I can thank him for doing that for me is by learning from the example that he's given me and trying to be an example for the brothers and sisters in my life. Because I have a little brother, and I know that everything I do, he does. Anytime I'll get out a yo-yo and play around with him, he'll go find his. Anytime I want to play basketball, he'll come out and challenge me. And anything I do, anytime I do something that's not right, he'll think it is because I'm doing it. And I think that if I can try to be an example like my eldest brother Christ, then maybe that will give my brothers and sisters in my home. Because I know that when my little brother is hurt by some friends or people that aren't friends, they have to answer to me. Because that doesn't make me very happy at all, that his feelings are hurt. And how does Christ feel when I treat his brothers and sisters well? And how well does that show gratitude to him who has done so much for me? I have a testimony of families, and I know that they can bring strength, and they can bring happiness and joy. And I know know that France can bring this too, and I know that if we can learn to love each other, then happy times are ahead for eternity. I know that we can learn from our eldest brother, Jesus Christ, and that we must every day try to be more like him and learn from his example and show him how thankful we are to have him as our brother. I love his gospel, and I love my brothers and sisters. And I say these things in the name of my Father, Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Pick a topic. Be thou an example came to mind. Stronger than the previous topic. I didn't understand at first what this had to do with the madrigals. And then I realized that every one of these friends of mine sitting behind me are big examples in my life. I can relate several times for each one of these people when they were examples to me. And I didn't say good examples per se all the time, but nevertheless, they are examples. And most of the time, they're really good examples. In searching for examples, I found an example of a small poem. And it is from the book, Minute Masterpieces, that I found on my shelf. It's entitled, Sermons We See, by Edgar A. Guest. I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather one should walk with me than merely show the way. The eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. The counseling is confusing, but example's always clear. And the best of all the preachers are men who live their creeds. For to see good in action is what everybody needs. I can soon learn how to do it if you'll let me see it done. I can watch your hands in action, but your tongue too fast for your own. And the lectures you deliver may be very wise and true, but I'd rather get my lesson by observing what you do. For I may misunderstand you and the high advice you give, but there's no misunderstanding of how you act and live. As many of you in the ward know, I had an uncle who passed away a few years ago. He suffered for 5 years of an incurable cancer. They tried very hard to cure it, but it just wouldn't be cured. 3 of those years, he spent in bed, not able to move or get up. He had a hospital bed that was in his bedroom of his home for the first couple of years, and for about the last year, it was in the living room so I could be closer to him. Through all his trials, and even though hardships were very rough for him, I've never met a more spiritual man in my life. And I don't know whether I ever would. Along with his great faith, he had the everlasting love and trust of his children. This is not, there is not a greater example than that of a parent to a child. Parents have a big responsibility to show their children the right path by example. Is a child going to listen to a parent tell them not to go to a rated R movie when they also attend the rated R movie? This is the problem that a lot of children face. You can see the evidence of children following the parents' example every time you look at a young child who mimics everything that his mom or dad does. My niece on the third row here mows the lawn with her dad, follows right behind the lawnmower, and cuts the grass. I wish you'd come up and cut mine. You can imagine what a young child might do if they saw their mother or father smoking or drinking. A scripture found in Jacob states, "You have broken the hearts of your tender wives and lost the confidence of your children because of your bad examples before them. And the soberings of their heart ascend up to God against you." We also have to, before we can be an example to others, be an example to ourselves. Another poem in this book, written by the same author, reads, "I have to live with myself, and so I want to be fit for myself to know. I want to be able, as days go by, always to look myself straight in the eye. I don't want to stand with the setting sun and hate myself for the things I've done. I don't want to keep on a closet shelf a lot of secrets about myself and fool myself as I come and go into thinking nobody else will know the kind of man that I really am. I don't want to dress myself up in sham. I want to go out with my head erect. I want to deserve all men's respect. But here in the struggle for fame and health, I want to be able to like myself. I don't want to think as I come and go that I'm a bluster and bluff, an empty show. I can never hide myself from me. I see what others can never see. I know what others may never know. I never can fool myself, and so whatever happens, I want to be self-respecting and conscious free. If you're an example to yourself, then you're never going to be able to do anything wrong. You'll become perfect, because if you follow your own example of perfect, then you'll be perfect. Of course, the greatest example that we can all ever have is Jesus Christ. He gave his life for us, that we might live forever with our Father one day. If we ever have any question of what's right or wrong, all we need to do is look to the scriptures and read about our brother and the things that he did, because every trial we have, he has had. I'm thankful for the opportunity to speak to you today and to share a message that I believe is a very important one. I'm thankful for all the many examples that I have in my life. I can look at every one of you in this congregation, even the ones I don't know very well, and relate more than likely one experience, if not so. I'm very thankful for my family, my dad and my brother. Have been very good examples to me in being a gentleman and doing the things that are right. It's because of them that I am who I am. And I hope one day to follow in their footsteps through going on a mission and through temple marriage. I'm thankful for all the people that are sitting behind me. They're more of an example than it might seem. And I don't know where I'd be without them. Again, I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ.
Until we meet.